I'm going to be shifting gears. So we've kind of progressed down from Tim to Mark and now to me. So Tim started very generally about World War I poetry, and Mark kind of continued in that vein. I'm going now on the very specific. So I'm looking specifically at the work of one particular person and how he viewed the war and his war experience. 100 years ago this April, the United States formally entered the First World War, a conflict that raged for 4 years and cost the lives of over 10 million men in arms. Horrific in nature, the war nonetheless represents a high point in literature, as countless men and women attempted to make sense of and remember their experiences on and away from the front lines. While the voice of British writers remains strong, the same cannot be said of their American counterparts. Familiarity with American writers is often confined to those that achieved some degree of fame during the interwar period, Ernest Hemingway and John Dos Passos, for example, due in part to their open disillusionment with the war's outcome and effect on society. This narrow focus greatly simplifies the quite complex and divisive American war experience and its effect on American literature, with the result that hundreds of ordinary soldier poets' voices have been muted in the decades since. One such voice is that of Byron H. Comstock, one of seven soldier poets I examined in my dissertation, which examines how the United States remembered the First World War. His personal biography is limited, although his volume of poetry, The Log of the Devil Dog and other verses, is digitized and openly available on Hathi Trust. Further information is only accessible through Ancestry.com and Newspapers.com, both subscription databases. I have selected Comstock for this paper because his poetry addresses the complex nature of the war experience. From all indications, Comstock appeared proud of his service, yet he clearly opposed the heroic and glorifying language used by politicians and civilians to describe the war. This voice of opposition, though different from traditional notions of dissent in wartime, serves to illustrate the diverse experience of American soldiers while also expanding our understanding of American literature in the early 20th century. Byron Herbert Comstock was born on October 31st, 1893, in Portage, Wisconsin. The details of his childhood and adolescence are unknown, but reading Comstock's poetry, it is evident he had a college education. Though not employing the technique of Alan Seeger, a graduate of Harvard and trained poet, Comstock's diction and language is more advanced than the average American soldier writing of his war experiences. There is also statistical data regarding the educational level of Comstock's future unit, the 6th Marine Regiment. According to the regimental commander, Colonel Albertus Catlin, 60% of the men attended and or graduated from college. Finally, there are two direct links to Madison, home of the University of Wisconsin. First, there is the headline of a 1920 Madison newspaper article published upon the release of Comstock's volume of poetry, characterizing him as an ex-varsity man, though I don't know what sport he played. Second, Comstock briefly appeared in the February 1921 issue of the Wisconsin Alumni Magazine, definitively confirming the poet's presence at the institution, though not the years he attended. Following the United States Declaration of War on April 6, 1917, thousands of young men rushed to enter military service. Despite the lack of information on Comstock's life, the poet himself offers an explanation regarding his decision to enlist. In the opening poem from which the collection takes its name, he states that it wasn't so much the picture, but the idea of waiting the call that got my goat. So I up and wrote my name above them all. The waiting he speaks of is likely a reference to the draft, implemented by the Wilson administration immediately following Americans' entry into the war. Comstock's words in this stanza and throughout the rest of the poem led credence to my claim that despite his subtle method of protest regarding language describing the war, the Wisconsinite supported American involvement in the conflict, writing of his experience with grittiness, but not overt pessimism or hostility. Following his enlistment on June 2, 1917, Comstock was sent to the Marine Corps Recruit Depot at Paris Island, South Carolina, an island spot that got so hot the grass burned off the ground. 11 weeks later, Comstock transferred to 84th Company, 6th Regiment, stationed at the Marine Barracks in Quantico, Virginia. In late October, he and his unit traveled to Philadelphia, where they boarded the USS von Steuben, a former German passenger liner turned auxiliary cruiser, seized by the US and outfitted as a troop transport ship, on its first transatlantic voyage under the American flag. Carrying over 1,200 soldiers and civilians, the ship arrived in France on November 20th, 1917, 2 months later, Comstock's unit, along with two other Marine Corps units, joined the American Expeditionary Forces 2nd Division. After joining the AEF, the Marines spent most of the next 6 months training with the French, seeing some action near Verdun, before taking up positions south of Belleau Wood, outside Chateau Thierry. Ordered to attack and seize the woods on June 6, 1918, the Marines endured difficult conditions and heavy losses before finally achieving their objective nearly a month later. Comstock's fight, however, lasted only the first day, taken out of action by a severe gunshot wound to the head. Although the record is silent on how long Comstock may have lingered on the battlefield without medical attention, he did reach a hospital, with the military notifying his father of his wounding several weeks later. The Wisconsinite finally rejoined his unit on July 11th, but then disappears once again from the historical record until resurfacing in October 1918 during the height of the Meuse-Argonne Offensive, the largest operation on the Western Front and a major element of the final Allied offensive of the First World War. Only a week before the armistice, Comstock was wounded a second time near Bayonville. Unlike Belleau Wood, where the record lacks detail regarding his transport to a hospital, Comstock's record after Bayonville indicates he was evacuated and spent the rest of his time in France in replacement units. Whether he accompanied the 6th Marine Regiment to Germany in December of 1918 is unknown. U.S. Army Transport Service records show Comstock departing Brest, France with his unit on July 1, 1919, arriving in Hoboken, New Jersey 5 days later. On July 15, 1919, Comstock was discharged and returned to Portage, having served 22 months overseas and attaining the rank of corporal. A year and a half after returning home, Comstock self-published his volume of poetry, The Log of the Devil Dog and Other Verses. Written either while recovering from his wounds or immediately following his return to the United States, or a combination of both, I don't really know, he doesn't say, so. It consists of a prologue, two narrative poems that serve as bookends, and 28 thematic poems. From the outset, Comstock sought to reveal the war to readers. The second line of the prologue states that he has seen the vivid heart of it, and I want to show it to you. Clearly, Comstock felt a responsibility to accurately depict his, and by default, fellow soldiers' war experiences. This is not to say that Comstock did so in the manner of John Dos Passos' Three Soldiers, a 1921 novel that, at one blast, disposed of oceans of romance and blather and changed the whole tone of American opinion of the war. Instead, the Wisconsinites subtly rejected the oft-used diction of poets like Alan Seeger, directly and indirectly challenging their perceptions of the war. In doing so, Comstock stands as an important bridge between the heroic and patriotic language of 1917-1918 and the more disillusioned literature of the mid-1920s. Many of Comstock's poems contain sentiments that illustrate the harsh realities of war, but there are several that explicitly oppose the positive view of the war held by many Americans. The first that stands out is The Sky Man, a poem that, as the name suggests, addressed air combat. A new field of battle during the First World War, air warfare appeared glamorous and heroic to civilians and troops in the trenches alike. Pilots encouraged this through their dress, behavior, and statements to newspapers. As a Marine on the Western Front, Comstock likely witnessed numerous dogfights, but unlike many frontline soldiers, did not walk away awed by their supposed valor. Avoiding romantic diction and writing about arguably the most romanticized aspect of the war, Comstock depicts less the arrogant, self-assured pilot, but rather one at war with himself. Recognizing his position as a king in the great blue ring of the vast and cloud-piled sky, the pilot remarks on his ability to see men fall, but not hear them yell. A stark conveyance of airmen's attitudes regarding their separation from the horrors below. They are responsible for death, but they do not feel its repercussions. Or do they? Comstock then transitions to a back and forth exchange where the pilot simultaneously asserts and questions his power and or authority to kill. Although his purpose is to kill, he longs to see blood spill, the slaughter drives me mad. This inner turmoil continues further in the poem, with the pilot forced to justify his actions and minimize the effects they have on his psyche. I would not do the things I do, I swear not, but I must. What to me is Earth's red sea and those specks in the lowly dust? Killing is morally wrong, but acceptable under present conditions, and he deflects personal responsibility for that killing through the characterization of men as specks. The climax of the poem, however, is possibly Comstock's best refutation of the heroism of air warfare. The lines describe one of the famous dogfights, but not in the manner readers typically heard. And it is worth reading in its entirety. Then up there soars, and above the roars, I hear the spiteful spit. Two madmen fly in the empty sky, in their game of nerve and wit. A sickening crash, an oily splash, my God, the tank is hit. A crackling sound, I dare not look around, why does the plane shake so? In a burst of flame no hand can tame, the plane drops hard and low. A skyman lost, I pay the cost, from heaven to hell I go. Without mincing words, Comstock directly illustrates the horrific brutality of air combat. There is no swagger, no glory, no entertaining flying circus. Just death, experienced in just a gruesome manner that is experienced by men in the trenches. In a similar manner, Comstock attacks the armistice, signed on November 11, 1918, casting it in far starker terms than the joyous occasion celebrated by many on the Western Front and Americans at home. "We have won" opens with death, or the Grim Reaper, as a terrible figure in cowl and gown, stalking across the now silent battlefield, grinning as one who sees his work well done in the battle's red rage. Here it is death, not the living or the Allied armies, that have achieved victory. Comstock's gruesome portrayal of victory lies in sharp contrast to the intellects of nations gathering at Versailles outside Paris to determine what will be written on the final page. Here too, Comstock ignores the pomp and circumstance surrounding the Paris Peace Conference, painting the meaning in more realistic terms. Largely ignorant of war's true effects, a select group of men, in this case Woodrow Wilson, Georges Clemenceau, and David Lloyd George, are set to determine the nature of the peace. Comstock continues in this vein in the second stanza, once more contrasting the horrific aftermath of war with events occurring in Paris. He writes of winter covering the dead, our rotting glory, only to have the warmth of spring, which is typically seen in a positive light, expose grim relics of twisted steel, while here and there, a decayed hand reaches forth from shallow grave. There is clear skepticism here, with Comstock indirectly challenging the very cause for which he himself fought for. The cynicism and sarcasm is brought home in the final lines of the poem, where he states, "In a famous hall, the learned have written victory on our page, and we have won." There is no joy here, no cause for celebration. Rather, Comstock emphasizes the hollowness of victory, questioning what in fact has been won. A final poem to draw attention to is Snap Out of It, a satirical depiction of the life awaiting returning soldiers. Despite soldiers' consistent struggles with poverty, the loss of loved ones due to going off to war and coming back different or strange, for example, and the effects of shell shock or mere involvement in the horrors of war, society expected men to snap out of it, to leave the war behind and resume a normal civilian life. This sentiment is a direct result of Americans' understanding of the war, the war's horrors largely concealed from the American public and the war's end ushering in celebratory parades. Civilians' grasp of what soldiers truly experienced in France was simply not in line with reality. Comstock's awareness and frustration with this knowledge gap, though evident throughout his volume, is possibly best expressed in this poem. It is unclear if Comstock himself struggled with the memories of his war experience. His available biography portrays a man who achieved both personal and professional success. After publishing The Log of the Devil Dog, Comstock left Portage for Kirksville, Missouri, where he met and married his first wife and attended the American School of Osteopathy. He and his family, they had a son, Byron H. Comstock Jr., born in 1923, later moved to Lakeland, Florida, where Comstock remarried and practiced osteopathy. I have no indication as to what happened with the first wife. Either she died or they divorced, but I don't know. Either way, he remarried someone. From all indications, he was well-liked and an active member in the community. The one-time soldier poet and Portage native died on November 20th, 1977, and is buried at Oak Hill Burial Park in Lakeland. Byron Comstock's The Log of the Devil Dog is unlikely to join its more famous counterparts as required reading in English classrooms, yet its literary and commemorative significance cannot be ignored. through the recovery of his poetry, the true nature of Americans' literary response to the First World War is revealed, a response far more complicated than that recognized by most historians. Comstock is patriotic but conflicted. He is neither Alan Seeger nor Ernest Hemingway, but rather the gray area in between, the bridge connecting romanticized patriotic rhetoric with gritty, even shocking, disillusionment. His poetry also provides a more nuanced understanding of American commemorative efforts, as war memorials, regardless of their architectural design or purpose, represent a more sanitized or acceptable lens through which Americans could remember and reflect upon the conflict.